Thank you and welcome everyone. Webinar on API testing. So before we begin, I would take only a couple of minutes to introduce myself, introduce our company, and introduce our trainer today. So we are DevLabs Alliance. We are an emerging information technology, software training, consulting, and staffing company. Our headquarters is in Gurgaon. We are conducting training on various technology domains like big data, blockchain, DevOps, AI, machine learning, automation testing, STAT, robotic process automation, all type of performance testing, soft skill testing, soft skill trainings, and the agile trainings. We are Microsoft authorized education partner. So we are conducting all sort of certification also from the Microsoft. We have our presence across four continents like Asia, Canada, USA, and Europe. We are having a very highly committed team. Those are helping us to create new technology programs along with staffing to various organizations. With this, today's training, we have a trainer with us. Her name is Ashwini. She is carrying extensive experience in the automation testing. She will be helping us today to understand API testing. So before I hand over to her, I request all of you to put yourself on mute. And there are two ground rules. So I request each and every one of you to please adhere to those ground rules so we can make this session as a very productive session. The very first, every one of you are on the mute. Second, this session is being recorded. So once this training, once this webinar will be completed in next couple of hours, you all will get the email to access recording. Those are not able to attend the session due to any reason, we will be sending them also recording links. And the third one, if you have any question, feel free to write all those questions in the chat window. Our trainer and the technical team at the same time try to answer all of your questions. Otherwise, we will answer your questions over the chat, or we will enable all of you to speak up and ask questions directly to the trainer. I hope every one of you agree with me. If you haven't used Microsoft Teams before, there is some option where you can go and you can use the emoticons to share, to express your feeling about the content, the concept that she is teaching, she's going to teach you. Like you can give the thumbs up, you can give the clap, you can give the heart, you can give hand raise. So based on that, she will be understanding whether you are understanding the concept or not. Again, I would request all of you to share or ask as many questions you want to ask in the chat window. And we have a technical team sitting here and we all will be answering all your possible questions. With this, I am handing over to you. You can share your screen and begin the session.
Yes. So I will share my screen first. Let me know.
Before you begin, Ashwini, I can see a couple of people has raised the hand. Jyoti, Sagar, Anant. So guys, please hold on till that time. We start the session. I hope you all have access to ask the question in the chat window. So requesting all of you to ask your question in the chat window. In the meanwhile, I hope you have seen the emoticons, I am clicking on the like, I am clicking on the heart, applause, and if you have a question, you can raise the hand also. So thank you everyone. Let's begin. Over to you.
Yes. Guys, can you see my screen? You can answer me on the chat box. So before starting with that session, so I will introduce myself. And myself is Ashwini, and I have basically 8 years of experience into automation and manual testing, and currently working as a senior automation engineer in one of the IT company. So before starting with the API testing, as we are covering mostly what is the API and how we can do the API testing, manual API testing or automation API testing through, you know, Postman or any API tool we are using. So before that, we will go with the basic concepts of why we are going with the API testing, why we need to use the API testing, all the concepts, okay? So before, as you can see, I will start with the introduction of the basic applications. What are the applications currently now? As you know, we are using client server applications or a web application, or it can be a mobile application. So those type of application and architecture of the application. And after that, we will cover the microservices, why we are moving to traditional web services approach to microservices. And after that, we are going to cover the basics of the APIs, why we'll go with the APIs and why we are using REST APIs only. So, and after that, we will cover the how we can test the APIs, basically those APIs with the, you know, Postman tool. And after that, we will go with the Postman overview, how we can download and install the Postman, and how we can, you know, use the Postman to test our basically APIs. And after that, we will go with the Postman, all the basic testing. After that, we will go with the Postman scripts. So how we can write the scripts with the Postman, how we can execute that. This is the automation, means we are executing the scripts using Postman automation. So after that, we can execute our scripts in bunch. Means suppose I want to execute all my scripts into one go, so we can execute that. So using one Newman tool, we can, see that. Okay, so first of all, I will go with the application. What are the types of application do we have and why we are using this, you know, microservices architecture. Now you can see or hear that various companies are moving to the microservices based architecture. Okay, they are not using traditional approach, means client server application. So that's why we will explain you. So first of all, client server application. For example, you know, there is a one website and we are logging into that website. Whatever we are logging means passing the username and the password, that is, you know, storing into one, you know, one database, that is nothing but server. And we are entering username and password, that means client. Okay, this is a basically a client server architecture. So in the client server architecture, basically divide mostly into a client and the server. Basically client is the computer and and all our requests we are sending to a server, and we are requested data we are coming from server only. So okay, suppose consider this is a very large small application. In a small application, it is a useful, if we are sending a small amount of data and we are getting a small amount of data from the server, okay, so it's a very easy for us. For consider the large application, consider the Amazon application. In Amazon application, thousand requests are going to the server. Means we are, purchasing something and we are, adding the products into cart and we are, searching various products onto the that site. So this is, millions of users are logging into one day and they are, trying to request and fetching the data from that server. So, this is the, if suppose any server application will down, so entire application will go down. Okay, this is the disadvantages of that client server architecture. So they come up with a solution that, basically moving to the microservices architecture. Why we will use microservices architecture. In a microservices architecture, basically our application is divided into different units, services units. Each service has its independent, basically it's a service oriented architecture. That means we are dividing entire application into interconnected services, means each services only have their, each services which communicate with another services. So that is the concept of microservices. And in a microservices, basically architecture, we are mostly using. Previously, we are using the monolithic architecture, basically, where all the software components and the applications are tightly coupled. Tightly coupled means each are depend on each. Means suppose one service is there, which is depend on another one. If suppose that service will go down, so the entire application will, you know, go down. So to come up with the solution, we have, they are coming with a microservices architecture, and each module have its own business logic, and each module have its own services. So this is a basically a loosely coupled application. Okay, so in a microservices architecture, we have a different web services as well. Web services means this is an architecture where communication is going with the client and server. So in the web services as well, we have a REST APIs concept. API means application programming interface. Why we are going with the API? Okay. So in an API, we have a two types of API, basically REST API and SOAP based API. API basically application interface. Means suppose I want two applications to communicate with. So how we can communicate two applications to interact with one another? So API is an interface, so we can communicate with each other. Consider the example of why we are going with the APIs. Okay, we have considering our data application. So our API, basically our front end is defined in one language and our back end is defined in one language. Suppose considering our front end is defined in a very traditional, HTML or a JavaScript based application, and our back end is basically in a Java or a .NET or C#.NET. Suppose so new technologies are coming right now. Okay, so if company wants to upgrade their application into new, means React or Angular based application, so they can easily change their UI. So to communicate with the database, okay, we are using some methods to call the API, database function. Suppose I want to delete the data from my UI. So I want to take the data from my database. So what we can do is we are calling basically those method in our code basically. So to communicate with the database, we want one interface so that interface interact with the database, take the data from the database and showing the database into our user application basically. That functionality is doing in a API. So basically API is a collection of function and the procedure, you can say. As you know, if we want something in our coding, any traditional coding, we are calling that method. So similar to that API, basically. It's a collection of function and procedure. So API is not depend on any languages. Means it is not dependent on any languages. Those are using HTTP mechanism protocol they are using, and they are calling the APIs, fetching the data, and they are showing. Basically, mostly data is in form of XML and JSON format. Why they are using the JSON format? Because JSON format is an easy way of parsing in any language. Many languages, they have already JSON libraries are available. That's why they are using JSON. Okay. So any questions you can put on the chat window. Okay. So okay. After that, hi,
one second, guys. So till now, I would like to summarize whatever Ashwini has covered. So guys, most of you already working in the testing domain or testing area, and you must have seen from last couple of years, APIs are very widely being used in almost all types of organizations, being small, big, or the MNCs. The reason behind this, almost all the companies are okay. So guys, please hold on. I am trying to cover
hello,
the content. Yeah,
hello.
So basically
hello sir.
Yes,
I'm audible.
Yeah,
yes, Vijay is there. My question is that our topic is about the how we can test the API exactly. Okay, Now everyone have the about the Abra, what is the exactly APIs, what is the backend, what is that, everyone have the experience about that. So what is the exactly you guys are telling us to the how we save our API and how we test their API. So is there any third party tool or is there any coding part for the, or any, is there any new thing in a Postman? What is exactly the simple thing is there? Can you please directly focus on that thing? Because our as per the PPT and as per the madam has explained to us, I am just listening from the 10 minutes, but it's like just a documentation reading. We guys can't understood actually, and it's also too fast. So can you please
wait, one second. I don't want to make this an argument. The very first reason is, if you see the agenda of today's session is, first, you might be aware about what is API and why we need to test the API and how to test the API. There are other people also, they might not aware about the APIs, what exactly mean by the API. So agenda of this webinar is to start from the very basics, and then we will be moving to the Postman. We will show you the live demos, how we can perform the API testing, what all things can be done, different, like, you know, the API methods, and then how can we write the automation script with the Postman, and then the integration of that script with the CI/CD pipeline.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah, so the basic is very much required. So there are a couple of people, those already working in this way, and there are people, those are very much new to this area. So we have to cater all everyone's need. So covering the basic first. So as I said, like, you know, you must have been heard about the APIs, and for the people, it's sometimes difficult to understand what does mean really by the APIs. And when we talk about the APIs, we also have to understand what is the reason suddenly in the industry everyone is talking about the APIs. Right. So I am summarizing what she has covered till now, and after that we will be jumping into the Postman. And again, I would request every one of you, please put yourself on mute and help us to cover the topic, right?
Yes, exactly.
Just that's why we like the way you are talking to us. It's very slow, precise, and we are able to understand. But Ashwani, she was going very fast. So just a humble request, please go a little slow so that we can understand. So, we are not in a hurry. We are here to understand and learn something new.
Sure, Vijay. I really admire your positive feedback on this, and we take it as a sport. The whole reason is we are giving everyone to opportunity to come and present whatever they have learned in this time. So you might find someone is having very strong, and people are learning on the presentation skill. So this is the platform where they can come and showcase their knowledge. I hope every one of you help her to share the whole knowledge, whatever she has on the topic.
Yes.
Right.
And one more request from my side to everyone who are joining in this event. Please don't ask these messages and messaging from the what is an API, we need a PPT or not, because if you just listen first time everyone, and if you seriously don't want not about the API, these things we can also learn from that YouTube or any documentation. So please fulfill this event carefully, listen, because the notification are disturbing to others also, because everyone types simple thing to what is API, need a PPT and this thing. So this is the disturbance. So this is my humble request to everyone. Just listen carefully. So that is also to help us for the Ashwin sir and that madam to that organize the event, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah. So guys,
Please go on the mute. So it's my humble request. So please, others can we have the great session by the team. Please go on the mute.
Yes.
So guys, I am requesting every one of you to please put yourself on mute. Regarding the PPT, regarding the recording, each and everything we will share with you. So the whole idea is to make this session as productive as can. So we all can utilize this 1 hour or 90 minutes time with the fullest, right? I have put everyone off the mute. Yeah, so I was saying, like, you know, the question might arise in your mind when someone discuss about the API and the API testing. So the thought is, like, you know, from where this API is coming up and why it is getting popular day by day. So the reason is, if we see broadly, our applications are two types of the application. One is the monolithic application. So monolithic application is the application that has all the code, every component, every module running on the single machine, right? So if you remember your old days when you were working in the waterfall model, developing one application that has a seller account module, that has buyer account module, that has product module, that has accounts module, or that has like billing, shipping, all the module are coded in the one project. Right. And with the invent of internet-based applications, when I'm saying the internet-based application, I mean to say when the more and more people are accessing our application, it becomes difficult to scale our monolithic applications. When I'm saying the scaling, so monolithic applications were good. I'm not saying they are the bad application or they're not going to solve the large population. But when I talk about the internet scale application, like, you know, Facebook, Instagram, Netflix, Walmart, or there are so many applications in your domain also, if you're working in the insurance domain, or if you're working on the e-commerce domain or healthcare domain, there are, like, you know, thousands of applications where day by day people are coming on the internet and they're accessing those applications and the load is getting increased day by day. So you might have seen in your big application, there are a couple of modules, those are being accessed very frequently, and there are modules, those are accessed very, very less. So when we are having the monolithic application, they are deployed onto the single server, and once we getting the more and more requests, we have to provision more servers, and we have deploy application on the same type of server. So with this, the cost of deployment, cost of management, everything get increases. So with this, the new concept comes into picture that called the microservices concept. It's not a new concept, I would say. It's just a way of modularize our application in a functional module basis. So it is something like, you know, it gives us flexibility where we can separate out our different application module to as a different service. Like, you know, we can have our accounts and billing microservice as a separate project that has its own database. It might have its own UI. Similarly, we have seller account module. It has own database, own UI, and we have, like, you know, n number of different modules. And now the thing is, like, you know, when we have the monolithic application, we will simply making a method call to invoke another module's method. But now, how we can consume the data or produce the data or send the data to other module when it is working as an independent application. For sharing the data between two different modules, there are various mediums. One of the medium is API. And the API is an abbreviation of application programming interface. And this is the way, or this is the way we can share our data or we can consume data from other application or other microservices. That is the reason the more and more APIs are being written, and these API can be consumed by any client. The client can be another application, client can be our mobile application, client can be our web-based application, or client can be any third party those wants to consume those services. An example is, you might have seen the weather website or weather portals. So they are exposing their weather portal. They are saying, okay, share your zip code and you will get the weather information. And you can use that API in your application, in your project. You might have seen on the Outlook is also coming up, and some other medium also coming up. So they have exposed their API. APIs can be consumed by any other team, any other company, based on their the provisioning model, how they're selling it, are they providing the free or they're charging for anything. And the second thing is, when they are sharing any API, we as a tester or the quality assurance people, we have to make sure our API is working as expected. For testing, so earlier days when we were testing our UI code with Selenium or Cypress or any other framework, we are testing our middle tier code or the backend code using unit testing or other medium. And for database, we are writing some database scripts to make sure our database is working perfectly fine the way we want. So now the new medium is coming up, like the APIs are coming up, and how to test these API. For testing the API, again, if I say in the broadly, there are two types or like a way we can write the API. One is SOAP UI, SOAP-based APIs that we call the web services. Another one is the REST API, that is basically an architectural style. And in the SOAP-based applications or SOAP-based web services, we are using the SOAP protocol to test it. But with the REST-based APIs, we are writing HTTP-based protocols that has popularly known couple of methods that you might all have heard about, like get method, put method, post method, and delete method. There are many more methods like option, patch, and the header. But these four methods are very much popular. Those are being used. Get method is to get the data from the server. Post method is to create a new record onto the database server or our to server. And the put is basically to update the record, and delete is for deleting the record. So now, like, we can see these are the four APIs are being generated. And now Ashwini is going to help us to understand how basically we can test these APIs. So there are ways we can test them manually, like, we can run over the browser, or we can use any tool, and we can test using the Postman, we can test using the REST client, we can test using the SOAP UI also. And in this particular webinar, we are going to share how we can test using the Postman. I hope it's clear to all of you so far. If it's clear, give me thumbs up. Great, thank you. So over to you, Ashwini. Showcase them how basically we can test the API and tell them, like, you know, what is the core component of the APIs. Thank you, guys.
Yes, sure. So coming to the API point, as Sachin already covered the APIs, so there are various tools we can, you know, do the testing with API. One of the most popular is Postman. So there are various tools as well available in the market, such as a ready API tool is there, SOAP UI is there, but we are going to demonstrate with this Postman. So you can go with the official site of the Postman and you can download that Postman. After the download, you can see the home as a screen. So after that, you need to go with the workspace. I have already been created as a one workspace. You can go with a new click work, new workspace, and you can create. After that, you can go with the workspace. Here you can see the different options are available there. So one is a collection, another one is API, another is environment, mock server, monitoring, and history. Why we are going with the Postman? Because Postman, you can easily, test our whatever the manual APIs as well. And they have provided the provision that you can write the automation script using Postman itself. And after that, you can import the collection and you can export the collection in the API. Apart from that, you can, execute as a, suppose this is my employee API collection is there. Suppose I don't want to execute that endpoint, again and again and or manually. So what we can do is we can just, go here and just export that collection, and we can execute it with one tool is there. That is a Newman tool, which is basically a JavaScript based tool. And we can, execute the scripts using that tool. Okay, we can type the command and we can execute that with this import collection. Okay, so first of all, I have already been created one collection. So sample API testing, you can here go and create the collection. This is my GET request. As you know, in the REST API, we have a different type of methods. First one is a GET. Second one is a post, third one is a delete, and the fourth one is put. So there are various types of methods available. I mean, options available, headers is also available, but mostly frequently used, these are the four methods we are using. So as you know, this is my entire even is a API, okay? we are considering. So this is basically a end URL. We are using this as an end URL. Okay. So this is my, as you can see, server's address, we can see, okay? And user means resources. So if you want to point out or you want to fetch the data from particular resources, we are putting this as a slash and resources. So I want particular user one's data, so I am putting one. Okay, so I will click, I have already been implemented. So how you can just create the collection, after that, you know, go with that, add the request. And after that, you can, you know, give the name to the request, whatever the request name you have to sample request. Okay. And okay, I want to execute this API. So how I can go? Here there are methods. I mean, get method, post method, put method, patch method, delete, copy, all these methods. So I will select get method because I want to take the data from this this endpoint with the one ID. Okay, so I will just go and click on send. As it's a GoGet method, so we don't need, you know, to pass the body. So basically we are fetching the data, we are retrieving the data from that endpoint, so we don't need to pass the body. Here you can see we are getting the response as well in the JSON format, we are getting the status code as well. As a part of the API testing, we have to make sure that our endpoint, whatever we are using with particular method, that should be working as expected. After that, we have to make sure that whatever the response coming from that server, which is in a correct format, or, you know, contents are also in correct format, we have to check, right? So after that, we have to check the status codes as well, because we have a different status codes in the API as well. 200 series is mostly a success message, means we are trying to send the request to the servers and we are getting the response in a correct format or success response. So that means 200, okay? So time required to, you know, fetching all the data. So size as well, the response size as well we are getting. And after click on the save response, we can save the response as well, okay? So in a body and in a cookies, we are not getting anything, but header information, we are getting the information about the content encoding and age and the server, okay? Test result, we are not writing any test cases right now. So that's why it's not, you know, test cases are not there, okay? So as a part of this, these are the methods. Here we are putting the endpoint. Here, these are the parameters. There are basically two types of parameters. First one is a query parameter and another is a path parameter. Suppose in a particular server, I want to fetch the data of the n number of users. Okay, so it's unnecessarily, but I want only a 100 ID numbers record. Okay, so I can just put ID equal to 100. Okay. And that will treat it as a my path parameter, okay? So after that, we have a query parameter as well. So suppose I want my data to be, you know, in a sorting order. I mean, whatever the data I am passing, that should be in a, you know, sorting order. It can be ascending or a descending order. So we'll use the query parameter for that. We are querying basically to the data. Data we are getting, but, you know, in a particular ascending or descending format we are getting. So we are using that query or path parameter. In authorization, so as you know, some servers are, you know, we can easily you know, interact with them and fetch the data from that server, but some of the servers we need to authenticate ourselves, means we need to pass either username or password, or we need to, you know, authorize with the keys. There are different types of authorization also available. In a header, why we are using header? So header, basically we are using so header means we are passing additional information. Okay, additional information means we are passing in which format we are passing, you know, requested body. If I want to pass the data to application.json or application.xml, we can pass the data. We are passing the like information in the header and body. Okay, suppose this is my get request. Okay, get request means we are, you know, fetching the data, but consider the example of, you know, post request. Okay, this is my post request. Here you can go and select the post request, and here you can just put the whatever the endpoint we do. Okay, so after that we will go with the here, okay? Body. Body, you have to select the raw, and after that there are different options. As you are sending the data in a form of JSON, so you can select the JSON, okay? And you can just simply send the data. So I am creating the data for ID number 12, okay? I will give the example ID number 12. Here you can say this is a JSON format. So this is my key and this is my value, okay? So ID, name, addresses. Addresses also contain its own, you know, information. So this is the form of JSON we have constructed. Okay, so I will click on send. Here you can see status, time and size, and body also we are getting as a, for ID this number we have created the record. Okay, so status is why 201, why not 200? Because 20 means we are you know sending the data and we are creating the data basically onto that server. That's why 201 is status code is there display. So we have to make sure that the status code is displaying as working as expected, and body, and we are pass submitting the data, so the data should be submitted. Okay, so here you can see this is a post request. Okay, similar to that we have, you know, put request as well, or you know, put request means suppose I want to update something in onto the server, so I can update that. Delete as well means suppose I want to delete this, you know, ID number 12 data, so we can, you know, delete the data as well. Okay, so these are the options available here. So this is basically you know manual way of testing. I mean, whatever the way we are testing, we can just create the sample you know collection, and we can, you know, add the requests and give the name to the request, and we can, you know, add the whatever the request method we have to add, and we can, you know, add whatever the request methods, and we can add all these things. Okay, so this is the way of manual testing. Okay, we are manually going and adding the endpoints, we are passing the data, and we are, you know, checking, we are checking manually. Okay, here also we can do a automation script as well. Here you can see there are two tabs are there. First one is a pre-request script and another one is a test script. Okay, so we can write the scripts here as well. Okay, what we need to verify as a part of the API tester, first we need to test whether whatever the method we are passing and whatever the endpoint we are passing, so we are getting correct response, we are getting the response status as a correct one in series of the 200, and whatever the we are response body we are getting, so it should be in a correct format and correct way. Okay, that is the thing. Positive scenario we are verifying. So negative scenarios also we can verify in that. So we are missing with some endpoint we are passing as incorrect. In that endpoint, if we are passing as incorrect, so we are getting status code as well invalid. Okay, 400 or 400 series means client side error. Basically, we are you know passing incorrect payload. Payload means body. Okay, we are passing the body, incorrect body. If suppose we are passing the incorrect methods, if suppose this is a, you know, get method and we are passing post method, okay, so that time also it should give me a status code for the invalid data. Okay, and if suppose I'm passing incorrect body parameters or missing body, then it should be, you know, show me the error messages. Those kinds of scenarios we can test manually as well, we can test, and we can test through the automation as well. So in a postman, as you can see, we can use the JavaScript for that writing the test scripts, and in a test tab we have to write the test scripts. Okay, so as you can see, I have already been created one employee details, and this is basically my dummy API. Here I have written one.
Yeah, I have an API. Hello.
Hello. Yeah.
Yeah, Ashwini, I am Rajeshri here. Actually, I have one question here. There will be two headers, right? One is while sending that headers is a request header and response header. What is the difference request header and the response headers? Is it same?
Yes. So here you can see this is a part of the request header. Request header means we are telling to the basically to the server that we are passing the information in a header. You can pass authorization as well as a part of additional parameters we are passing, okay, so that the server or whatever the resource we are trying to access, that will recognize that yeah, this is the request, and it is passing additional parameter as a whatever the content type or content length they are passing and all those things. Based on that, they can recognize and they can send the response. Okay, suppose this is an endpoint where we don't need any authorization, or we don't need to pass any additional data, but some of the APIs, okay, so they need additional authorization. So whatever the additional authorization, we can pass from here, okay, as a key parameter, so that they will recognize that this is the additional parameters they have added, and they are validating with that header information, okay. So after that, we have a response header. Okay, response header is basically coming from, you know, whatever the servers we have. As you can see, they will pass the information about whatever the you know, endpoints we are trying to hit, that URL information, and whatever the server we are trying to access, they will give the additional information about that server. Okay, that means our response header.
Okay.
Yes, yes. Any other questions? So let me know. So we are trying to cover this again as well. If you have any questions.
Swini, after so the URL that we are passing, can you please? Yeah, after the URL, like type in pcode.com user one. So exactly, I'm not getting what exactly that is.
As you can say, this is the URL. Okay, this is URL. That means we are pointing to, you know, this end URL. Okay, that means server's URL. Okay, we are fetching the data from one server. So we have to type the address of that server, right? So
okay, yeah,
this is a basically address of that server. Okay. HTTPS means we are using communication protocol as a HTTPS. Okay, this is the address. After that, this is the resource. So as you know, consider the example of banking application. In banking application, I want to access only net banking. Okay, there are various steps of transaction as well. I mean, we can do through net banking, we can go with a Paytm, we can go with any. Okay, so suppose I want to go with that net banking's Paytm. So what I will do, I will type the address of net banking, and after that I will use the Paytm. Okay, so in that Paytm as well, I have
Just hit that URL in the any browser and show them so that they can understand easily what it is displaying over there. That data you can show them and explain the things very well, I guess. Users, hit that URL in browser, what response you are getting, and after querying one, what are the responses you are getting. In such a way, you can explain the things.
Okay, Veta.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hi, Ashwini. My question is like, who will provide the URL, like your development team?
Mostly development team as well can provide the APIs. If suppose that APIs,
Okay, and for manual testing, what is your agenda for we have to test APIs, like all the things will provide a developer or not?
They will not provide you all combinations of the things. They will provide end URL, sample or request body,
so basically,
and the response body.
Ashwin, I can take this question. So basically, when you are working in any organization, they have some kind of documentation. Right. Yes. So the documentation I need to see here, the kind of contract, like what you have to send in the request and what you will get in the response. If as a tester, our responsibility, or as a developer, our responsibility to make sure what is expected and what is actually is coming up. Right. So the developer will give us a document in a form of Swagger UI or in a form of different way, where they will be giving us this request has to be passed and you will get this response. right? So every information will be given by the development team, those are developing or those are writing these APIs.
Okay. Just is the responsibility just take the response and the status code and the response time? It's like
no, we have to test everything. I mean, we have to test the response body as well. We are whether we are getting the correct response body or not.
Yeah.
If suppose yes. You want to verify whether I am, you know, creating the resource. I mean, everything is treated as a resource here. So name with the correct name or not. Here I have given the dummy name, but you have to make sure that, you know, because sometimes what happens is that we are, you know, verifying the crude operations as well. Means one API's response is dependent on another API's request as well. Means request response training. That okay, time, you know. That
we have to test each and everything, and this what is the server what we are sending the request and what is the server will provide, the we have to categorize on the basis of status code, which is we are writing correct, we are following correct method or not. Yeah, right.
Yes. So we have to make sure that status codes as well.
If you see, like, you know, status code is one thing. Let's suppose there are various status code like 200, 400, 500. There are various status code, right? So one status code can give you 200 means like you are successfully able to get the report, right? Now you have to verify whatever is being returned from the server is so are their value correct? So you have to make sure whatever value response is being returned from the server, their value is as expected. So you can go back and query in database. You can go back and check the documentation that is provided by your client. So you can do all those things. This is basically the validation, we can say. You have to verify whatever response is coming up. Is it the one that is expected? If it is yes, then your test case is passed. Otherwise, it's fail.
Okay, so sorry for in my disturbance. Here is Vijay again. So basically, it's about the server side validation responsibility and also for the developer side responsibility about the test the API. What are the as I can understand from that this scenario? So there is the validation from the server side. Whatever the type of response code they guys are sending. Sometimes what happened, the response is failed. Suppose the user is not found in the database. Then also sometimes we get the 200 response code. That is the wrong actually, right? So at that time the response code should be 401 and like that. It's a correct.
Can I answer this question? My name is Ashish.
Yes.
I'll not take much time. So first thing we need to understand what is API. So this is based upon the client and server architecture, right? There is a one client, there is a server. In the example, the one she is showing, we are behaving as a client and we are hitting a server and to get information of the first user. Okay. So when we do the API testing, there are something called like client side validation. There is something called server side validation. In the client side, you have a client URL. Okay, and the server URL is there, client ID, password, the authentication part, the one she has showed, and that you need to verify. So if the client, the correct user ID password is not going, so you will get 4xx. But at the server side, like suppose there is a technical error, at the time you hit the server, the particular server is down, right? In that case, you will get 5xx. So the way you test, I think your question is more relatedly how you will test, right? So the first thing, whenever there is an application which is required API testing, it is a proper documentation given by a team. It can be either developer, it can be a designer, it can be a business requirement document also. Each and everything will be there. What is the URL, which method you need to use, and there will be sample request for everything like get, put, post. You need to use that. You have an application knowledge. Based upon that, in that particular key value pair, you will pass your information. And you will write a test cases based upon that. You based upon the result, you will say this is pass or fail. Suppose you hit a request, you got an error code, right? Then you will go and see the microservice document also. In that, it is clearly mentioned. Suppose you are getting an error code 7 for your particular application. In the document, it is mentioned what's the value which you are sending. This is wrong. Then you need to correct and send it again. So it is like that. So the main important thing, this is a client and server based architecture. application behave like a client, it can also behave like a server. Suppose I am acting like a client, I'll hit a server, I will get a response, I will store it in some buffer table or somewhere else. Another microservice in my application, it will pick and process further. Okay, yeah.
So what do you, as per this, yes, I appreciate your answer and I'm also happy with that. Now my question is what? This is the API, there is another window. This is about the users list one. So you think this API is secure or not secure?
I think we should hold on our oval question. Otherwise, the session will not go into complete first.
Yeah.
Let her complete first. At the end, we should ask her kind of questions.
Exactly. Yeah, because, I have a lot of questions, so we will.
Let's wait.
Ask it soon, or because, we can contact us too personally, and we will ask it later after the session.
Yes, yes. Because there are other people who are actively listening, and this kind of question answer it is disturbing other people. So I think we all should hold our questions, and we'll ask later on.
Okay, Ashwini madam, you can continue.
Yes, yes. So here you can see I hit this URL, so we are getting this response here as well in the browser as well. Okay, so as you can see, okay. So after that, here as you know, this is the basically a collection, and we are basically fetching the data and we are validating that. This is the basic one. But suppose I want verify this with automation, through the automation, how we can do that? So we can do with Postman script. So Postman given us one object of the Postman, so that PM is an object, so we can use that and we can write the test cases. So how we can write the PM dot test? Okay, so PM dot test is the command, so we can write that, and after that we can give the name to the test cases. So I want to verify the status code. I will write this, verify the status code. Okay. So this is a basically a JavaScript resource. So I'm writing the anonymous function here. So after that, we have to verify is whatever the response we are getting, which is of 200 response or not. So I will use postman.response, pm.response dot who have. It's basically a assertion library they are using. So we have to use that, and we have to use status. Okay. So whatever the status we are expecting here is 200. So I have written this script. So once we will start with execution, it will first start with this method and all authorization, as we are not providing header, also we are not providing. It will execute, and after that execution response, it will go with the test and it will try to execute that postman test script. Okay, so I will execute that. It's same here. You can see in a test result we are getting this verify status code. This is my test case name, and 200 as we are getting, so it's a pass. Okay, I will make it as a fail, so the test case should ideally be fail. So here you can see verify assert code, assertion error, expected response. Okay, but we got 200. So whatever the expected response we are getting, this one should be correct. Okay, so this is the way we can write the test scripts in the Postman. Pre-request script tab is there. Why we are using pre-request script? Okay, so as you know, we have created the add users. Okay, so this is basically a post request. Consider the scenario. First of all, we have to submit our user information with the ID, whatever the ID we are getting, 12. Okay, based on that 12 ID, we have to fetch the data of that user.
Hi, sorry to interrupt you. This is Ranjit Kumar. So can we use the conditional statement in the test, like we want to verify the response, whether if it is, suppose we have to response type, like response one and response two. Based on the response one, a status code should be 200, or based on the response two, it should be response code should be 400 or 300. Can we apply in the conditional statement as well in the function method, like we are applying the test?
I mean, you are saying, suppose I this is my status code, this should be 200. Conditional basis as well we can apply, but here, you, as you know, we are applying it to the response body. Whatever the response we are getting, we are just checking with the status code. So that's why I have written that. So we can use the, you know, condition like, you know, suppose my response should be blank. So first of all, we have to read entire the response in one JSON file, I mean in one variable, and after that we have to retrieve that particular. If suppose my ID is blank, so
I have given
guys I am sorry to disturb you, so please, you know, don't interrupt the session. Please hold on your question. Other participants are also, like, you know, wanted to learn something. So please hold your question. We try to answer all your question after the phase completes. So please continue. Thank you very much.
Yes, I will briefly give the answer. So first of all, we have to read the entire JSON body into one variable, and after that we will retry whatever condition. Suppose my address I am getting the blank. So my response code should be 400 or a 300 series. That kind we can do as well. Okay, so here I'm just demonstrating it with you, a basic status code. If suppose I want to read the JSON data, so what I can do is I will use the const variable data, and I will use, you know, pm dot response dot response dot JSON. Okay. So here is the way we are getting the response body in a JSON format in the data. Okay, and you can, you know, use the data.id. You will get the data ID here. That way you can, you know, just to verify whatever. I mean, if you want to verify the ID and contents as well, expected as well, we can verify that as well. Okay, and after that we have another concept like import and export. Here you can see the option of import. So as you know. Data. Actually, I'm network issue.
Yeah, Ashwini. Yeah, she's back.
Yes. Suppose you are working as a team, and you know, your team member has given you the collection and you have to test that. So no need to create an entire collection and entire, you know, endpoints here. What you can just go with that, and here is the option. So you can give your collections the export. Click on the export. The collection.json will be, you know, whatever the JSON, it will be getting stored. Okay, so it is stored in the form of JSON file. So here you can just download that. Suppose you want to import that file. So how you can import that? Just to go with the file import. So whatever the collection file, here is the option of import with file folder link as well there. So you can just use the Swagger link as well. And here I will go with the file and upload file. Okay, whatever the upload file is there, suppose sample. Okay, so I will open that, and here it will give the option of import. I have already that sample API testing, but I will show you. It will be getting as a, here you can see already exit import as a copy. So I have imported. Here you can see you are getting automatically all this API file. So you can use that. Okay. So any questions for that? I mean, import, export, we can use. And after that, we have, you know, advanced concept as well. I mean, whatever, you know, whatever we are using here, we are passing any, you know, hard-coded, any URL, we can pass it through, you know, parameterization or other variables as well. I mean, Postman, we have a different variables as well. Means collection variables are there. Global variables are there, environment variables are there. suppose I want to test the this for one QA environment. Suppose in a QA environment URL is different, or production environment or a UAT environment URL will be different, so we have to test like that. So no need to change the request entirely. We need to parameterize those things, parameterize the variable. Here you can see there are there is option of set as a variable, so we can set that. Okay, after that, suppose I want to execute this entire script in one go, so how we can execute that? So we have to use the we have to first download the Node.js. After that, you have to use the command npm install human tool, which is basically a JavaScript based tool. And after that, we have to type like newman run. We have to go with that directory first. I'm just copying that whatever exported here with the desktop is there. The desktop. I will go with the desktop and I will type the command as newman run, and we have sample API testing postman collection that we have exported right now, right? So I will write here, so it will try to execute that. Okay, here you can see this is getting executed, and in a request it's one error is there. Okay, add user error, runtime exception. Okay, so get request is working as expected, but that post request is not working. Get.
Because already IDE is already used.
No. Actually, what I did is I have added the empty for the demo. That's why. Okay. Sample request. So after that, what we have to do is we have to export it again. Okay, whatever the collection we have written, we have to export it. Suppose I'm writing this as a only testing postman. Okay, what I will do is return. Here you can see I have to go with that testing postman collection dot JSON. Collection could not be loaded. Wait.
You need to open the command prompt one more time. New command prompt you have to open, Ashwini.
No. We can do it through here as well, right? Later. I will use here.
Guys, she's not distributed.
Okay, so here I have written one script as well for the demo, right? I mean, whatever the const data I have written, so that's why here we are getting error. Otherwise it's working as expected. Here you can see identified data is already been declared in the test script get users. Okay, so that's why we are getting exception. Otherwise, you can, you know, use the command like Newman run, and whatever the collection you have, you are exporting here, we can use that. Okay, same thing what we can do in a CI/CD pipeline. Okay, in a Jenkins, we can, you know, execute, we need to install the Newman tool. And after that, Newman tool will get installed. So there is a one option that execute the Newman, I mean, whatever the Newman application tool. So we can, you know, type just the command. After that, it will get executed through the Jenkins as well, similar thing. But first, we need to install the Newman tool before that. Any questions about
Ashwini? I think you forgot to explain about a pre-request script. In between, someone asked some question, so you skipped it.
Yes. So why we will use pre-request script if we have a test script? Okay. So in a pre-request script, suppose you know, I want to send the data to this request, or I need to execute some data. So what we can do is we can use the pre-request script here. Okay, no need to, you know, I will show you with the example. Okay, so you will not get suppose this is my you know, whatever the body I am passing. Okay, so here I am passing the hard coded every time. It means every time I am passing hard coded value, name and salary and age. Suppose you are passing the ID as a, you know, whatever the ID, but in every time you are requesting to the server, the ID should be unique. Okay, so here you are passing 111, and second time, you know, it should be, you know, unique one, otherwise this API will not work. So in that scenario, what we need to do is we need to make sure that ID, whatever we are passing, it should be you know, unique. And every time you are not going to, you know, go to that collection and go to that API, and you will not change the ID variable, okay, ID variable with some values. So you need to make sure that it should be a dynamic. So how we can do it to the dynamic? In a pre-request script, what we can do, we can write a one, you know, code to you know, generate the random number, okay. And that random number, whatever the generating the random number, we will store in one variable, I mean, whatever the collection variable or any variable, we can store, and we can pass the data to the body here, okay, so that we can access. So that way we can, you know, use the pre-request script. Suppose I want to send the some data to the body with a dynamically, or I want to, you know, read some data from one API, okay. Suppose I want to call one API before this API, okay, before this post API, I want to call the one get API. So how we can do that? We can, you know, use the pre-request script for that. First of all, you know, that pre-request script will execute it, and after that, this whatever the endpoint will execute, and after that, test script will get executed. Okay. So here I have only show you the status code. So here you can verify entire thing. I mean, whatever the response JSON we are getting, we can retrieve that and we can verify that. Okay. So any questions right now?
There is like authorizations that we have to use a bearer token, like auth 1, auth 2. Like, can you please explain?
Yeah, there are various types of authorization. Okay, here no auth means we are not using any authorization for this. Okay, so we have a basic authorization. In a basic authorization, whatever the username and password you will pass, it will be converted into Base64 format, and after that, you know, it will be added as a part of header parameter, or it will be added as a header parameter, and it will, you know, that server will recognize that it is a valid user that I am trying to, you know, sending the data to to that client, which is a valid one. So client recognition will be done with that authorization, so basic authorization. So bearer token is also there. Suppose that username and password, whatever we are sending, that is, you know, in a part of a headers. So that is not a secure way. So another option is that token. That token we are passing, it will becomes here as well. I mean, suppose I will take the example of token. Okay, so I am passing random characters here. But in a real time, whatever we are using, okay, that token, whatever we are passing, that is generated from one API only. Suppose I want to access, in an Amazon server. So Amazon will recognize only to the valid users. Okay, so first what they will do is they will introduce one API. That API will recognize, this is a valid user, so that whatever the authorization will be done with that API, the API will send one token. So for another request, we will use this token and we can, fetch the data from that, server. So that mechanism we are using in authorization and other as well. I mean, basic OAuth mechanism is there. Those advanced authorization mechanisms are also there. So nowadays we are using OAuth 2 mechanism. We are not using OAuth 1.0. So other as well, we are using bearer token. XAPI key is also there. Suppose I want to use that XAPI key, that will not going to be changed every time. So we can use that API key and we can execute our APIs.
Okay. Hello, Ashwini.
Yes.
Hi, this is
Hello.
Ganesh.
Hello.
Just wanted to know what is the language you are using in the automation script?
What is the
language, like programming language you are using for automation script in test tab?
Yeah, we are using JavaScript basically.
Okay, other than JavaScript, so can we use any other programming languages to enhance it, to make use of conditioning, loop statements?
Here as well, we can use the conditioning, right, in JavaScript. Okay. Because in Postman, we can use only JavaScript because they are providing us a object, means that control of that, Postman. So
only
Postman
JavaScript
is an
can
object.
Be used. Only JavaScript can be used with Postman. And also, can you please give me examples on 3xx response code, in which scenarios we get?
Okay, I mean, first one is a 200, as you know, okay? So yeah. Second one is a 201, okay? And third one is a internal server error. Suppose server, down, okay, server will be down. So how you can, so you will get an internal server error, that is means 500 series, okay. Suppose whatever the request you are sending, okay, that is not a correct way, so that server will send the error as a 400 series. I mean 400, that is bad request. Okay, that server is itself a request itself is a invalid. Okay, after that, this is the URL which doesn't require any authorization, okay? But some of the, APIs are there who needs authorization. Means we are, accessing authorized servers. So what they need? They need authorization. So we are passing only a correct end URL methods body, but we are not passing any authorization, right? So in that case, we are getting 401, that means unauthorized. I mean, we are trying to access, basically it requires some authorization.
Any scenario in 300 series?
300 series means we are not getting mostly 300 series, status codes. Yes, mostly 400 and I mean, suppose redirections are there, status codes, response redirections are there. That times we are getting, 302 and 304 kind of error.
Thank you.
250.
Yes.
Thank
you for
clarifying. Hello, ma'am. Yeah. Hi, Ashwini. I have a question.
Yes.
Hello, ma'am. You can go ahead.
What is in that cookie and what we are testing cookies?
Yeah, can you just speak loud?
What is meant by cookies and what we are testing cookies?
Yeah.
So cookies are basically used for session tracking. Right. Yes. So we have to sometime like, you know, we have to maintain the session. We have to track the session. Session means like, you know, after logging into the application, we wanted to record what all calls being made, when these call has been made. So cookies helped us to maintain that session.
Yes, yes, yes.
And guys,
hi, Shuni, I have a question. Database is required for the API testing.
So from where you will get the data? Right. We need database has to be placed somewhere, either if we're developing application or writing the APIs, then we need to store the data, right? So for that, we need the database. If we are consuming some other third party APIs, they might be using their database at their end. So in that case, we're not concerned of what database or which database they are using. But yes, to store the data, we need database.
Means when we use the post request, firstly we enter the data values, then after send the post request, we check out in the database, right?
Okay, so let me put in that way. So I hope when we are working on the application, you must have heard about the CRUD, C-R-U-D. Any application is having these four basic operations: create record, read record, update record, and delete record. For creating a record in REST API, it gives us a post method. So very first call that we are making is a post call to create the record in our database. And then we want to read the data that is created. We have to make the get call, and we can provide the record ID. Based on the ID, the data can be returned to us. Now, if we wanted to update the data, we have to make the call put. So put will update the record. When we are updating, making the update call, so we can, in the request body, we can pass certain fields, those value we want to update, and it will update the record in the database. And the fourth one is delete. If we wanted to delete that record, we can pass the record ID and delete, we can execute the delete call, and it will delete the record from the database. Behind the scene, developer has to write the logical part, how to create the record, how to read the record, how to update the record, and how to delete the record from the database. I hope it's clear to all of you. And guys, for those are pretty new to REST APIs, I am giving you a very simple way to remember status code. So there are multiple status code. Some are very frequently one, those starting from 200, there are those starting from 400, there are starting from the 500. So when you see 500, 1, 2, 3, 4, you can think about there is something wrong with the server itself. Once you see 400, like 40, 1, 2, 3, 4, it means server is fine, but our request is having some trouble. We are not making the correct request. And when we see 200, like 200, 201, 202, it means our request is fine, our server is fine, and we are getting the response back. Now we have to test whatever response body is coming up, is it up to what we are expecting? So that comes like in our usual work that we used to do to match expected versus the actual. And there's one more question came in regarding the authorization and the authentication. So authentication and authorization, you can think about it like, you know, let's say in your organization, you are logging into your internal portal. That portal is having two access. One is admin view, another one is the client view or the employee view. So we, first of all, we have to log into the portal. So basically we are authenticating ourselves and we are logging into the portal. So admin can also log in, simple user can also log in, authentication is done. Means we are the part of the organization, we can access that portal, so authentication part is done. Now, there are certain fields or certain pages, certain tabs, those are visible to only admin, and there are certain fields, those will be visible to only user. So this is basically authorization. So admin has authorized us to view only two tabs, while admin itself can view multiple tabs. So this is the authorization. So in any application, when we wanted to control the view or control the access of different application modules, we use authorization, where basically we are limiting the authorization. There, you might have seen, there are multiple types of user: master user, admin user, department wise user, and the general user. So this is way authorization and authentication works. As Ashwini also shared, when we are basically writing, when we are accessing or making calls to API, almost all the APIs are secured by different meaning or different ways. Some are using OAuth, some are using bearer token. So if you are using APIs in your organization, so you might have seen, first time we are passing our client ID and secret, and then we'll get the token. And when we are making the API call, we have to pass a token. So this is the way it basically authorizes us to access any API. So it totally depends application to application, organization to organization, what methodology or what medium they are using to securing our APIs. By default, if someone asks you, so do we have SOAP APIs or REST API, are they secure? So we can say they are not secure. By default, there is no security. We have to implement the security the way we wanted to. I hope it is also clear to all of you.
Yes, yes.
Great. Yes, so you, sir, as I said in a couple of times, you all will get the recording thing, so don't worry about that part.
Thanks. Your answer was very clear.
And we get response from.
Thank you. Thank you, Anand. And I can see one more question from Elena.
One question also I have, that is it possible that we get empty response? And in that case, what HTTP code should be?
Okay. So as I said, like, you know, you can think about 500 will never give the response back, right? The 500 will give us a message, okay, server, there is some internal server error, means there is something wrong with the server end that we cannot control. And when we are getting the 400 series response, it means there is something wrong with our request. Let's suppose request is expecting to pass the customer ID and the customer name, but if we are not passing the customer ID and the customer name, we will not able to get the response back, right? So it will give us a 404 or request is incorrect, something like this, and we'll get the message. But when we are making a 200, we're getting 200, there are very good chances there is something wrong at the API code itself that is not returning the response back to us, but it's returning the status code 200. So yes, there can be the scenario. There can be the coded in such a way, it is not going to return anything. Let's take an example. When we are deleting any record from database or from the system, we are making delete call. We are passing the ID to delete the to the record from the database. So it's up to the project requirement. They can return us back the message record successfully deleted, or they might not be returning anything. So it totally depends, and it's true. The response can come blank also. That we need to investigate whether it's expected behavior or we need to log an event.
So as a tester, as a tester, do we don't have any influence on the API? We are just basically testing the client and the server, basically.
Correct. So Pat, basically we are consumers, right? So in any organization, there are two teams. One is writing the API, another one is testing the API. So we don't have any control to rectify that the issues until unless we are working in such a team where we are writing and we are testing end-to-end APIs. Yes. If anything goes wrong, we are just consuming it. We are maintaining that our test results and sharing with the development team.
Hello, sir.
When you start an organization, you basically get the API documentation from the developer to basically see was to be expected.
Correct.
Okay.
It's true. So basically, like, you know, in most of the organization nowadays, Swagger UI is being used. If you heard about the Open API or Swagger UI, it's basically a documentation that covers what is expected, what is your endpoint URL, what you have to share in the request, what data type you have to share in the request, what data types you will get in the response, what will be the error code or the response code you will be getting back. So all those details are being shared. In the development terminology, it is called as a contract-based development, or it is called the contract. So contract means when someone is going to consume our API, right? They need to be very much clear what has to be shared in the request and what I'll be getting in the response. So let's suppose if I have to consume someone's API in my application, or I had any data from third party application, I have to very much clear what I have to send in the request, what data type has to be, whether I have to send the customer ID in the form of a string, or I have to pass in the integer, or how it will be. So those details should be very much clear, and developer or the development team will share that detailed document with you right before doing any kind of testing. So be assured, when you're working in any team, you will get a detailed documentation. Without that, it's very difficult to, you know, IT doesn't work, or it can never work based on the assumptions. We need facts, we need data, we need documentation. Based on that, we can test our application. Okay, and I got one more question. Yeah, thanks, Pat. I got one more question from Swaroop and Navya. Just guys, you know, give me a second. Sure, but I will cover SOAP also. I'm first taking a couple of questions SOAP also.
I don't know if you explained the difference between SOAP UI and REST. Why would they use SOAP? Why would they use REST for API? I'm not sure. I think you. I don't know if you covered it already.
I will cover again. I will cover again, Pat. So I am first taking, like, you know. Guys, I didn't get your question. Come again, please.
Sir, what we are now? What we are testing in the header?
Okay, so I will cover header part also. Just give me a second. I am taking some of the questions. Those are in the chat window. So Navya and Kumar Swaroop also asked the question. There will be a lot of API. One API response for another API. From testing perspective, we have to validate whether all the attributes are as per the requirement, validate the content, etc. It's true. API can be consuming another APIs, and we have to test all those scenarios, all those possible things to make sure whatever is being tested or whatever is being sent to us, it's working as expected. And I am going to the Navya's original question. She is saying, I am new to the API testing. For the manual API testing, I understood that as a QA, we need to check if JSON response or status is as expected. But in agile methodology, same thing can be done by dev as well. But how does QA make valid addition to the product? Very good question, Navya. So basically, I can do some corrections here. So when we are working with the APIs, and if I specifically talk about the REST APIs, it is not mandatory we will be using only JSON. It's all the preferred to use a JSON, but you might see in different teams, in different companies, different product, they will be using XML, they might be using text, they might be using CSV, or they might be using JSON. So it totally depends what data type we are using. And this is the one of the advantage with the REST API, that you can use n number of data types. And now the second is, it's true, as a QA, we can test manually, we can test the automated way also. Usually, when the developers are working, they are writing the white box testing, or they're writing the unit test cases. For writing the unit test cases, they might be writing JUnit test cases to make sure whatever code that they have written, it's working as expected. As a automation tester, we can write scripts using the Postman. Developers and the quality engineers can also write integration test cases using Rest Assured, using FreshBe. There are various options available. And when we are working as a tester, we are having a different view point of view to see an application. Developer, those are writing the code, they are very easy to tend to skip to various scenarios or various issues. But as a tester, we are writing regressively the functional test cases, integration test cases, end-to-end test cases, and for that we are creating the collections in our Postman, and we are running those collections. We are adding our test cases in the CI/CD pipeline. So with the automation script, like, you know, using JavaScript, we can write this script. So once developer is making code changes, committing those changes, and the pipeline runs, it also makes sure whatever change is coming up, it's not breaking our existing functionality. Okay, I hope it helps you to cover. And okay, there are more questions.
My question is that, like, what is my collection? That means it is by API request or something.
The collection, I have, okay. Ashwini, would you like to take the answer, this question on the collection? Ashwini? Okay, no worries. So basically, if you see in the Postman screen, you can write n number of REST calls, like get, put, post, and multiple times you can use all those calls. And now you wanted to run those calls in a single shot. So you can export from the collection and you can execute them. Actually, you're on mute. And
please explain your question.
What is your question? What we'll be sending in the header?
Yes.
Okay. So in the header, we can send, like, you know, what content type. Like you know, when we are, as I said, okay, I will come into this question. First, I will cover the Pat's original question. And I think with this question, I will be able to answer your question as well. So the question comes into picture, like, you know, we know there are two ways or two popular ways of writing the web services. One is SOAP-based services. Another one is REST-based services. So SOAP-based services are primarily dependent on the SOAP protocol. And when we are writing the REST-based services, it's like an architectural style where it uses the HTTP method. When I'm saying, like, you know, what is the main difference between SOAP services and the REST services, there are, you know, key points. The one point is SOAP services are comparatively heavy in size than the REST services. Now the question comes, like, you know, how they are heavy and how they are light. So if you see the structure of the SOAP services, they have first envelope, then they have header, then they have response body or the request body. So if you see, this structure is very much same, the letter that we are posting to our friends or to our family member. So on the envelope, we write the address where it has to go. On the header, we put all the security information, like, you know, who can access this this envelope, and then we can read the body part where we are passing actually message. And the limitation, or I would say the SOAP services are supporting only XML data type for request and response, while in the REST APIs, they are having header and the body. There is no such envelope thing. Header is also optional. In header, in our REST APIs, generally, we are defining what data type request we are sending and what data type of response we are accepting. As I said, REST supports n number of data types, like, you know, JSON, XML, text, CSV, Word, Excel, PDF, you can name it and you can use it, all those kind of things. There are various API, various jar files or dependencies available that you can use to code the application. So if one of the application or one of the API providing data in XML as well as JSON format, but as a consumer, you want data should be returned in a JSON format only, then in the header, you can write content type application JSON. So you will get the response back in the JSON. So whatever information we are passing in the header, it got interpreted by the application code itself to serve our request in such a way, so we'll get the response in which format we are expecting it. I hope I'm able to answer both the questions. And the most important or major difference between SOAP and REST, where it is being used. SOAP services primarily used to interact between two different systems when they are working on two different technologies. So they are using the SOAP services. They are very good way of communication between two systems. But once the internet started booming, we are getting a different types of devices. We are having like, you know, IoT devices, we have the mobile devices, we have portals, we have apps also. So REST services, as they are built upon HTTP protocol, they are very fast, they are stateless, they are not carrying any additional data load like, you know, envelope or other stuff. They are in a JSON format, they are lightweight, and their communication is very fast. And they are working on the HTTP protocol, so they are best suited for the internet. That is the reason all the net-based or internet-based applications are using REST, and that is the reason almost 90 or 95% of the microservices are being developed using REST API. I hope I'm able to answer your question, Pat. Okay, so yes. I got one more question. Yeah, thank you. I got one very good question from the Joe. Can we use Postman as a web server to receive a request? I heard about mock server, but not sure this is what I need. Can you please explain? Sure. So Postman is not a server. Postman is a medium to test our REST APIs. And the mock server is something when the developers are writing APIs or they are testing the API, doing unit testing. They have to test some service, like a payment service they have to test. Like they wanted to make sure whether the payment is being made successfully or not. For that, they have to use the payment gateway. They have to make the payment transfer. But when they are testing, it is not feasible for them to make the payment transfer in real time. You don't want to spend your money again and again for testing something. So the mock servers are the API, like in Mockito. If you are using the Java, PowerMock or Mockito, you can use it. And you can create a proxy server of your client API to test, to give you similar kind of experience that you are accessing the real services. I hope it is making sense to you. Any more question, guys?
What challenges we are facing while doing API testing?
Okay, what challenges we are facing when we are doing the API testing?
Yeah.
So the major challenge is like, you know, we have to, so every testing requires the understanding the scope, right? What we have to test and till when we have to test. So as such, if your requirement is very much clear to you, I don't see there is any challenge that you will face. The major thing, you should be having the good understanding about the underlying tool that you are going to test the application. It is very much important.
Okay. And it depends upon like your requirements and what types of bugs we have generally found while doing API testing.
The type of bugs you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay. So bugs that we are getting, like, you know, our request is not right, or server is down, we are not getting the proper response is not coming in a proper format that we are expecting. And the second most important thing is, what happened? We might see the incorrect response code is coming up, right? So yeah, Namrata said, so there are very good chances where we will see the incorrect response codes are coming up. So we have to make sure if response is coming okay, then it should be 200. If resource is being created, it should be 202. So all those things should be there.
Okay, and one question is like, what are the different types of API testing? Like, we have already covered a functional testing. We have to put it. Other than that,
so all those things like, you know, the functional testing, end-to-end testing, regression testing, these are the core testing concept, and they will remain same whether you are testing UI, whether you are testing database, whether you are testing API, or whether you are testing the middle tier. They will remain same. Now the only thing is how you are testing.
Can you please go on the mute? Nisa, can you please go on the mute?
Yeah.
Of testing like API testing, functional testing. We have to, for regression testing, we have to also use the Selenium tool. So in that case, we have to use API testing like for regression testing.
Okay, so Selenium is used between them. No worries. So don't worry. Selenium is used only and only for UI testing. Its name is Selenium WebDriver. You can test only UI testing with the Selenium. But when we are working with the APIs, then if you are doing the manually API testing, you might be using REST, this Postman tool, very popular. Insomnia is one of the tool. REST client is another tool. And if you are using the, if you have used SOAP UI when you worked with the SOAP services, you can use SOAP UI also for testing also. So that can be used. If you want to automate the API testing, you have tools like, you know, the Postman plus Newman, and you can use Rest Assured, FreshBee. So there are multiple tools are available, but there is clear segregation between Selenium and the API test. So Selenium can be used only and only with the UI based application. And guys, I am sharing, I need your support. I am sharing the our Google page review form. It will not take more than 1 minute for you all. So, quickly give us your review.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, I can see one more question is coming up from the, okay, so many questions are coming up. Hema, it says, Sachin, how to extract API from any website, or where can we see API in application? So basically we cannot see the API in any application. The reason is they are coded behind the scene in the code itself. In some of the companies, they are giving their API package, or they have exposed their API package to consume by other team or other company that you can use. I am giving you one example, so you can see how. Just give me a second. So I am sharing in the chat window. So you can quickly open and see. This is from the RazorPay. RazorPay is Indian payment gateway system. They have given very nice documentation of the API reference. So they're basically saying, if you wanted to use our API, our RazorPay payment gateway in your application or your portal, how you are going to integrate it, you can use our API and you can consume it. So this is API documentation they have shared with the public. Those wanted to use, they can click on it and they can understand how it can be used. It is very elaborated documentation. So the similar kind of documentation will be shared by the client or by the company where you are working.
Okay, sir. I'm Vijay. I have one more questions. Hello. Can I ask my question?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, so my basic simple question is that how we can make our API secure? It's depend on the language tool, or it depend on the code, how a developer do the code. Suppose I'm an Android application developer, okay? I have a basic knowledge about the database, how to create your database, everything. Even I had created a small APIs and the websites. I don't want to hire any backend developer. So can I make my API more secure using Core PHP, or I should learn Laravel?
Sure. Okay. So basically, when we call it as an API, the very first thing is API are independent on the programming language. You can write any API using PHP, using Java, C#.NET, Python, Ruby on Rails, Go language, Rust language, whatever language you want to use, you can write an API. As I said earlier also, by default, APIs are no language provides security to the any API. We have to implement security layer to the API. And now it comes how we want to secure our APIs. You might have seen some of the API or the websites URL start with the HTTP. And some of them started with the HTTPS. S means secure, hypertext transfer protocol secure. So what it does mean, it provides the security at the transport layer. If you have done the BTEC, you must have learned about the OSI layers. So in the OSI layer, one layer is transport layer, means where data is actually being flowed. Right, from the data from one server to another server will go. How you want to send the data? So you can use the HTTPS, so data will go securely. This is the one way. Second way is you want to place authorization and authentication. You want only people who are authorized to my application can access my API. Then you have to implement your security mechanism. You can use JWT token, you can use OAuth, you can use bearer token. So there are multiple mechanisms that you can use to secure your APIs. So no programming language provide the API security, you have to implement the security.
Sir, one question.
Suppose we are getting the collection from the dev team, right? And there is a possibility there, the collection that we receive, there is some mistake or some ID has been changed. So although we are testing on like Postman and all, so how we can verify the developer that has been given that particular collection of that particular API is correct or not?
Okay, so because in most of the cases, Ajit, the team, the developers will always give you the APIs. They rarely, like in some team, if you have kind of setup, they will be sharing the collection with you. But most of the teams, they are sharing the API endpoints with you. It's your responsibility whether you want to create through the collection, you want to create just simply add and run that APIs. So it's up to you how you want it to use. So again, it's once it is given to you, it's your responsibility to go back and check.
But we receive in the form of Swagger, right? So like how we can verify over there, right?
Then you have to see like, you know, who is basically managing those collections. If any change is being done in the resources or the endpoint URL, then the person who is making changes, ideally he should go and update the collection also. So making sure like, you know, everything will remain inconsistent with the system.
Okay, yes, sir.
Okay.
So, Sachin, thanks a lot for your session. It's really helpful and we really appreciate
it. Yeah, sure. And guys, like, you know, again, I'm saying, please give us a review if you feel this session helped you to understand. Again, I'm sharing. And guys, we are already like 15 minutes ahead. So we have three minutes left.
One question, Sachin.
Okay, sir. Sachin, sir, there is an important thing, or you can take this thing as a suggestion or in for the future your events. I would like to suggest that can you please make any event for the workspace for the Postman Postman workspace, because everyone have a simple question about the collection. I would like to put forward my opinion. So don't be export or import the collection every time. Please prefer the creator team in a Postman. There is a live updation using if you have an online workspace. If you know that, can you please, Sachin sir, can you make one video or one next event only for the workspace? How the workspace is working on a team. Suppose the backend developer do the any single changes on their system, they automatically be update the methods and the variable, everything will automatically update on that collection. So team will be notified that automatically. No need to download or export or import any type of collection. This is the, it seems like a professional and professional work and the teamwork. So it is also helpful to everyone to time consuming job to export or import collection and every time to download and that all.
Sure, Vijay. Sure.
Yeah. Hi, Sachin. Sachin. Like a very basic question I'm asking, sorry. So if a developer creates a code for some functionality and if he wants to make it as an API, how does he generate that API? Like, does he uses any tool to create those APIs, what he has written the code for some functionality so that we can consume the API?
Sure. So basically, the developer is writing code, so you must have heard about it, writing the functions or method while they're writing the code, right?
Yeah.
So these functions, within the programming language, within the code, one function can make call to another function. If you're using the object-oriented programming language like Java or C#, you will create the object and make the call to create the call the function. Similarly, writing the API, there are some specification given by the programming language itself. If you are using Java, there are JSR 168, 208, some specifications are there. That can be used, like, you know, if you're using Spring, Spring Boot, Spring MVC, you can write the API. So there are different frameworks available at the development side to write the APIs. Right, so there is no, I would say there is no tool, there is, like, you know, the frameworks that they use to write the APIs.
Okay, those APIs, nothing but the code that I have written for the functionality.
Correct.
Okay, thanks for clarifying, Sachin.
Can we, yeah, Sachin, any recording code upcoming event for the rest is your API?
Yeah, we will be, like, you know, conducting every month free sessions. So as you are registered now, the team will share all the details about our upcoming session. So you will stay in touch with us and we will be coming up with different sessions.
And about the recording.
Yeah, is the recording available?
Yeah, session recording is always there. And today's session recording also, we will be sharing once the session will be over. So you can expect the recording by Monday morning as tomorrow is holiday. So you all can start expecting the recording by Monday morning.
Okay,
thank you.
So much,
Sachin. Just one question.
Nice job you did. Okay, Sachin, sir, can you please share your LinkedIn and you want a conversation?
Am I audible? Hello.
Yes, you're audible. You can ask the question.
Yeah, see, currently in my organization, I'm doing the API testing in a manual way. Okay,
mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
I wanted to learn the automation part, the one Ashwini was showing. But I don't know from where to start, I need to go for some Udemy channels or some YouTube. Can you please guide me from where I can start and learn to do the API testing using automation?
May I know your name, please? I am unable to.
My name is Ashish Gupta.
Okay, Ashish. I will make sure, like, you know, my team will connect with you and help you out to start from where you can start the automation of API testing. So we have ample amount of resources available with us, so we can help you out with that. Yeah, I am sharing my email ID also. So if you have any question related to your learning, feel free to write it to us. And one of our team member will help you out in learning that concept.
And just one feedback here.
I think
Many people have joined, most of the people will be like a first timer. So just a suggestion, when the next time you are making a session, just have an agenda, because here I felt like she has just given an example, okay, this is get put and all. Instead of directly jumping to automation, it is better for the newcomer and all the other people who are like new to API testing. If you can show what is a get method, okay, one call, what is a put method, delete method, or all this thing, then jump to the next session where we are doing automation, and there should be some agenda. Okay, these are the things which you are going to show as an example. That will be really helpful, because I felt like it's at the end or in the middle, it turned up become a QA kind of QA and kind of session.
I do understand, and I understand the reason is this topic is very interesting, and I can see we had very great audience also today. So everyone very much enthusiastic to share their knowledge and wanted to make it more question answer session. I do understand, but it's very good feedback and we take it as a positive lean. So hopefully we will improve upon on this in our upcoming sessions.
How can Emmanuel Tester, you know, test, you know, the API manually, or is this course based on manual testing or automation testing?
Okay, so as Ashwini has shared, the manual tester can test using the Postman directly. They can add the endpoints and they can supply the request body and they can test it. But the testing in an automation way, you have to have basic knowledge of the JavaScript programming language. You don't need to be expert on the JavaScript, but if you have basic level of knowledge of JavaScript, then you can easily and quickly learn the automation of the API testing.
Do you guys have any training on Java, on training people on Java, you know, to have the, you know, to have the knowledge of Java? Do you have any training, you know?
Yes, yeah, we are having trainings on the API testing also, and we are having comprehensive program on the automation testing also. I'm sharing the link. You can go through this link and it will be very, very helpful for you to get the understanding about the entire automation testing landscape.
Oh, okay. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks for being a great audience today. And as I said, we will share the recording with all of you by Monday morning.
I have a last question, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Yeah. How I can contact you? I just need to talk with you, like by call.
Yeah, there's same question from my side, Sachin sir. Yeah. I am also finding from the last 5 minutes to you on the LinkedIn, but I am not finding to you. So finally, I am going to send a mail for the I want to connect to you with you. Can you please share your LinkedIn ID on our conversation?
Yeah, I will definitely share. I will definitely share. I am sharing right away.
Thank you,
Sachin. Please share here so we guys can connect.
Okay, I'm sharing. You can send me an email, training@devlabsalliance.com, and I will be.
Okay, so here, Vijay, I am just sending you the mail. Please send your the LinkedIn connection URL so I can connect with you.
Sure.
Yeah, thank you, Sachin.
Yeah, thank you, everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sachin.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye, everyone.
Thank you, Sachin. Thank you, Ashwini. It was a nice one. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, developer teams.